Thank you. The roots of violence. Wealth without work. Pleasure without conscience. Knowledge without character. Commerce without morality. Science without humanity. Worship without sacrifice. Politics without principles. Mahatma Gandhi. Yang berhormat Dato' Joseph Sanggadom, Deputy Minister of Information, Communication and Culture. Yang berbahagia Tun Hanif Omar. Yang berbahagia Tuan Puan Umar Samantan. His Excellency Mr. Kamal Malhotra, UN Resident Coordinator and UNDP Resident Representative, and Mrs. Anita Malhotra. Your Excellencies, members of the Diplomatic Corps, Honourable Judges, learned speakers, Yang berbahagia Tan Sri Dato' Clifford Herbert and the Board of Governors of the Montfort Boys Town, Brother John Albert, Director, Montfort Boys Town, the Board of Trustees of the Gandhi Memorial Trust, Tan Sri, Dato' Dato', Datin Latin, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, or maybe I should just say today, friends. Namaskaram, Assalamualaikum, good evening. Welcome to the third Gandhi Memorial Lectures. The United Nations General Assembly on the 15th of June 2007 unanimously adopted a resolution to declare Mahatma Gandhi's birthday, the 2nd of October, as the International Day of Nonviolence each year. Today, Malaysia joins the rest of the world in celebrating this important day, which is also the 143rd birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. The Gandhi Memorial Trust of Malaysia is making its own small contribution by organizing the program this evening. To honor this great soul whose name is synonymous with peace, there will be a couple of lectures today, as well as the presentation of a public service award. The Gandhi Memorial Trust is pleased and so honored that the United Nations is represented here in the person of His Excellency, Mr. Kamal Malhotra. And I would now like to invite His Excellency and also Yang Berbahagia Dato' Mahathir Shankar, former chairman of the Gandhi Memorial Trust, to come up on stage and thereafter deliver their introductory remarks. Your Excellency, if we could invite you to the podium to make a few introductory remarks.
His Excellency Ambassador K. Kesavapani, President of Singapore Association, Governor of Singapore International Foundation, and Singapore's non-resident ambassador to Jordan, past director of the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies, where I first met him and benefited greatly from his generosity and friendship. Mr. S. Radhakrishnan, Chairman of the Gandhi Memorial Trust, whom many of us in this room know as Malaysia's ambassador to the diplomatic corps. Yang Berbahagia Dato' Mahathir Shankar, who needs no introduction, the former chairman of the Gandhi Memorial Trust. Tan Sri, Dato' Dato', Datin Datin, Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. A very good afternoon to all of you. It gives me great pleasure to be with all of you here today, both as the UN Resident Coordinator for Malaysia, but also as an Indian citizen. I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate the Gandhi Memorial Trust in Malaysia for organizing these Gandhi Memorial Lectures and bringing us together for the observance of this very important day, as well as for its continuing efforts to promote and advocate a culture of peace and nonviolence. The United Nations International Day of Nonviolence is a day that is now observed globally to promote nonviolence through education and public awareness. It is annually held on October 2nd to coincide with the birthday of Mahatma Gandhi, leader of the Indian independence movement and a pioneer of the philosophy and strategy of nonviolence. He once said that, and I quote, "Nonviolence is the greatest force at the disposal of mankind," end of quote. According to the UN General Assembly Resolution A/RES/61/271 of 15 June 2007, which was just mentioned, this resolution established the International Day of UN of Nonviolence and is an occasion to, and I quote from the UN General Assembly Resolution, "disseminate the message of nonviolence, including through education and public awareness," end of quote. The resolution reaffirms the universal relevance of the principle of nonviolence and the desire to secure a culture of peace, tolerance, understanding, and nonviolence. We at the United Nations strive to harness the power of nonviolence to overcome prejudice and conflict and cultivate mutual respect and understanding among peoples, cultures, and countries. The UN Charter established nonviolence as an important principle guiding all our work. Article 1 of the UN Charter states that one of the UN's purposes is to settle international disputes or situations by peaceful means. Equally, the efforts of the UN to promote tolerance, respect for all human rights and fundamental freedoms, democracy, development, and mutual understanding are all underpinned by one common idea, which is to make lasting and sustainable change. Our efforts must be undertaken peacefully and in the spirit of cooperation. As you know, the United Nations was created after the devastation and misery created by World War II, and in the hope not only of ending wars, but also of making them unnecessary. The UN's founders hoped that the organization could help stop violence by spreading a culture of peace, promoting tolerance, and advancing human dignity. The United Nations Charter clearly champions a peaceful, nonviolent approach as the first recourse, utilizing means such as negotiation, mediation, arbitration, and judicial settlement. A nonviolent work to build peaceful, stable societies takes many forms, from promoting values and norms to establishing institutions. The rule of law, sustainable development, and building and making peace are among the key elements of the UN's agenda for nonviolent change. We are striving to intervene early, before tensions escalate, and speedily when they do escalate. We are strengthening our strategic partnerships so we can respond more quickly to crises while supporting national institutions for mediation and dialogue. Ladies and gentlemen, these ideals are identical to those of Mahatma Gandhi and his legacy. His peaceful struggles against unjust regimes, both in South Africa and India, captured the world's imagination. At a more personal level, they were one of my most important inspirations, significantly shaping my commitment to the UN Charter's ideals and the work I have undertaken over the past 3 decades to address the root causes of social injustice, inequality, and poverty, both at national and global levels. The Mahatma's incorporation of nonviolence into everyday life also inspired countless individuals to lead better, more meaningful lives. The Mahatma's ideals and actions are needed now more than ever. All around us, we see communities increasingly mired in rising intolerance, racial and cross-cultural tensions. We see extremist dogma and violent ideologies gaining ground as moderate forces retreat. In today's world, we face many hostile forces as well as multiple and persistent crises which demand an urgent and appropriate response from both national leaders and grassroots communities. Mahatma Gandhi understood that a powerful idea could change the world. He knew that individuals working alone and together could realize what others might dismiss as impossible dreams. Inspired by Mahatma Gandhi's life of nonviolence, the United Nations strives, for example, to rid the world of weapons of mass destruction. As part of the UN's Weapons of Mass Destruction campaign, we seek to raise awareness about the high cost of weapons of mass destruction. But calls for nonviolence should not apply only to the use of deadly weapons. The United Nations and its grassroots partners have long campaigned to stop the human assault on our planet. Significantly, increasing greenhouse gas emissions have been a consequence of this onslaught and now threaten catastrophic climate change. Likewise, the appalling violence inflicted on women and girls throughout the world should also be at the center of our concerns about non-violence. An estimated 150 million women and girls are victimized each year. Rape is increasingly widespread as a weapon of war. Victims of sexual coercion are more likely to suffer sexually transmitted diseases, including HIV and AIDS. The UN urges all partners to join Secretary General Ban Ki-moon's Unite to End Violence Against Women campaign, which is a multi-year effort aimed at preventing and eliminating violence against women and girls in all parts of the world, since no country is immune to this malaise. Ladies and gentlemen, on the International Day of Nonviolence, let us celebrate and embody the legacy of Mahatma Gandhi by enhancing and sustaining a global movement for nonviolence. Let us end violence in all its manifestations and strengthen our collective work for a safer, greener, and more just and peaceful world for ourselves and for our children. We at the United Nations will continue to work in common cause with all people who share the UN's aspirations for dignity, security, and equal opportunity, and will take appropriate and determined actions to realize these goals in cooperation with all of you. I thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, and now let's hear from Yanubhadi.
Born Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, he became a legend in his own lifetime, the Mahatma, and he, in my opinion, and many others, was perhaps the most illustrious of India's sons in the last century. To represent India, we have here present today His Excellency Mr. Vijay Gokhale, the High Commissioner for India, and his dear wife, Vandana. If only for that reason, Excellency, I would like to put you on the top of my welcome list for this evening. Vandana, your name is both an invocation and a welcome, and with your blessings. Young Barohmat, Dato Joseph Salam, Deputy Minister of Information, Communication and Culture. Yang Utama Tinggi Tun Hanim Omar. Our two distinguished speakers for today, His Excellency Mr. Keshava Pani and Dato Dr. Anwar Fazal. My companion at arms for so many years in the judiciary, Tan Sri Dr. James Fok, who is going to chair the event this evening. 30 diplomats here this today with their wives. I can't single you out one by one, so let me compendiously include you all as your excellencies. 13 or 15 judges from the High Court and the Federal Court, honorable judges, a special welcome to all of you. Tansri, Tansri, Puansri, Puansri, Dato Dato, Datin Datin, ladies and gentlemen. On the 30th of January 1948, when a man by the name of Nathuram Vinayak Godse emptied his revolver into the Mahatma as he was coming out for the evening prayers. His intention was to silence the voice of this saint once and forever. Paradoxically, ironically perhaps, far from silencing the Mahatma, his voice has never rung more clearly, more simply, more meaningfully in all the years that has followed his passing into immortality. Indeed, the pinnacle of that path to fame was the announcement of the day of his passing as World Nonviolence Day. For me, and if I can say this briefly and quickly, in a world torn apart by violence, it seems that each time this cycle of violence reaches its apogee or its height, somebody comes along to show that there is still hope for us and that there is another way that we can do things. The latest such example, and what a shining one, was Aung San Suu Kyi. After years of incarceration in the shadows, to come out into the light again and preach the gospel. Today we have three people to come and pass on the message, the chairman and our two speakers, and I'm confident that in the context of our present times they will have something very meaningful to tell us. As your supernumerary chairman of the Gandhi Memorial Trust, let me confess that the best thing that I ever did as chairman was to pass over the reins to my successor, Mr. S. Radhakrishnan. This evening and this event is going to be a success, of that I am sure. We owe it largely to him and to his indefatigable secretary, Nazim Bibi Binti Ibrahim. The culinary arrangements and all the goodies that you're going to have later has come within the tender care of his wife Pankaj, who is also going to look after me at the dinner table. We also have to thank a whole lot of others, including the ushers who have come from the University of Malaya, the Asian Law Society Institute, the members of the press who are here to carry the message across cyberspace into every corner of the globe, and a special mention to our charming MC, Chek Norina Yahya, with whom I share a special affinity. She is an action girl. Action, not only in terms of action, but she was also one of the products of the law firm of Shern Delamore and Company, since then known only as Sherns. So she is action, she is from there. And I'm very, very happy to be standing here today amongst all of you and to be treated to the wonderful words that will shortly be showered upon us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Excellency Yamabahagya Dato. May I invite you to return to your seats below. Ladies and gentlemen, before we proceed any further, please allow me to acknowledge the presence of Madam Manjit Kaur Gill and husband, who are representing the Sarawak Indian Society. Welcome. And we also have a message from the president of the Mahatma Gandhi Foundation of Canada, based in Montreal. Mr. Suraj Sadan has emailed the president of the Gandhi Memorial Trust here in Malaysia, Mr. Radhakrishnan, and conveyed these greetings, wishing everyone the best for the success of this evening. I'd also like to make mention of the beautiful sketch and painting that you might have seen as just before you entered the hall. This is the work of an emergency physician. A doctor was very adamant that he made clear that he's not a lawyer. Yes, emergency physician, Dr. Abdulali Raja Muhammad, and both those works won first prize in their categories at the All India Intra-University Art Competition. And thank you, Doctor, for letting us display those wonderful works. Honored guests, ladies and gentlemen, the next item on our program are the lectures. So may I now invite to the stage His Excellency Ambassador K. Kesavapani, President, Singapore Indian Association, Governor, Singapore International Foundation, and Singapore's non-resident ambassador to the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan. I'd also like to invite to the stage Yama Bahagia, Dr. Anwar Fazal, Director, the Right Livelihood College, University Science, Malaysia, Penang. Ladies and gentlemen, this session will be chaired by Yama Bahagia, Tan Sri Dato' Sri Dr. James Fung, retired judge, Federal Court, Malaysia. Tan Sri, if you will join the gentlemen speakers on the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, Tan Sri will be introducing the speakers, but permit me to tell you a little bit about Tan Sri himself. He graduated from the University of London with a Bachelor of Laws honours degree in 1969, called to the English Bar by the Honourable Society of the Inner Temple, also called to the Malaysian Bar, and was in private practice for almost 20 years before being appointed as a judicial commissioner in 1990. He was then elevated to the High Court in 1992, with a Court of Appeal in 2005, and finally served as a federal court judge until his retirement earlier this year. Now, if you spent some time here, you'll recognize the cases I'm about to mention. Some of these notable cases during Tan Sri's career include Bakundan, also the Highland Tower cases, and of course, Tan Sri was also the chairman of the Royal Commission of Inquiry into the death of Teo Beng Hock. Tan Sri is a prolific writer. He's written a book, The Malaysian Judiciary. He's also written numerous articles for journals and magazines and presented at conferences around the world. Now, if that wasn't enough, he currently keeps himself busy as an arbitrator appointed by the International Court of Arbitration of the International Chamber of Commerce, as well as the Kuala Lumpur Regional Centre for Arbitration. With that, I now hand over conduct of proceedings to Yama Bahagia, Tan Sri James Fung.
Deputy Minister Tun Tupuan, Tan Sri, Pan Sri, Honorable Judges, Dato', Datin, Chairman of the Gandhi Memorial Trust, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here to introduce the speakers. There are two speakers today. I shall introduce one by one, i.e. after the first is finished, then I introduce the second. First, I start with His Excellency K. Kesavapani. In 1997, the Singapore government had to make a major decision as to who to send to Kuala Lumpur to take up the rather difficult job as High Commissioner to Malaysia. At that time, many disputes remain unresolved. Topics such as the water treatment plant in Johor Bahru, and then the supply of water. Then, of course, not forgetting the railway, and more important, the station at Tanjung Pagar. And also, of course, the bridge or the causeway. Now, all these, if it is not handled properly, can threaten the relationship between the two countries. Wisely, they discovered and selected His Excellency K. Kesavapani. Reasons are obvious. He was practically made in Malaysia. Born in Kuala Lumpur, educated in Ipoh, graduated from the University of Malaya, and married a Kuala Lumpur girl. What more do you want of a Malaysian? When Kesiva Pani, and we fondly refer him to as Pani, arrived in Kuala Lumpur, he fitted in like a fish to water. Practically everyone talked to him and his wife, Padmini, and for those who knew him personally, we had a great time on the golf course, drinking, talking about practically everything under the sun. But of course, he was rather guarded as to Singapore policy towards Malaysia. I think he was more of a listener, a fine quality of a diplomat. He was extremely popular, but not without substance. He has extensive experience as head of Singapore delegation to the United Nations and then to the United Kingdom, as well as to the World Trade Organization. Now, to diffuse many of these nitty-gritty problems between Malaysia and Singapore, he was indeed the right man. Now, when I say about nitty-gritty problems, it can be an off-the-cuff statement by the then mentor minister of Singapore, Mr. Lee Kuan Yew, who said that the crime rate across the causeway is on the rise and there's a danger to Malaysians. And can you imagine, and all of those who lived through that era, uproar in the south, down with Singapore, and of course, we continue to go down and they continue to come up. But somehow or other, with Pani's tech experience and contacts, he managed to serve his term and completed it without any incident. So much so that when he retired, the Singapore government offered him this prestigious post of Director of the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies, which, to my mind, could be something like a CIA, but he denied it. But officially, it is a think tank organ, policy advisor to the government on all foreign affairs. He told me that he has retired, but from his CV, as all of you have read, he is now ambassador to the Kingdom of Jordan. I believe that there could be still one golf course in the kingdom for him to continue his diplomacy. I now introduce you our distinguished speaker.
Thank you very much, Tan Sri. Now, to give a right of reply to that would take an entire session. But I've been asked to come for different reasons. But let me say how much love and how much affection is in this hall. Really, I'm overwhelmed by so much of friendship and affection. Therefore, I'm going to do something which normally is not done, and that is to take as though protocol has been set, and we will proceed straight to what I want to say. When, as the charming MC said, there are many events all over the world, including one in Singapore, where the grandson of Gandhiji, Tushar Gandhi, is speaking, and I was to have chaired that session. But when Malaysia's most distinguished non-official ambassador calls, you say yes. So when Radha asked me to come and give this talk, I said yes. I said yes because it always gives me an opportunity to come back to the town of my birth and to meet all of you. I also would like to pass a message. In fact, what I did was a bit naughty. When Radha asked me to come and speak, I said, why not ask former President Mr. S.R. Nadu to come and speak? You know, the usual A-line, they shoot the arrow at you and point it out to somebody else. And Mr. Nathan was very, very keen to come. And he's also the patron of the Mahatma Gandhi Memorial Hall in Singapore. He was very, very keen to come. Unfortunately, his health is not what it is. He's 88, just a few months ago. And so he put the arrow back to me and said, you go and speak, but you convey the good wishes, my good wishes, and the good wishes of all of us who are attuned to the Gandhi movement in Singapore. So here you are, and here I am. I'm very grateful to the Gandhi Memorial Trust for giving me this privilege of participating in the celebration of the life of the Mahatma. When I told a friend of mine that I was going to give a talk on Gandhiji, his response was, what for? What is that to say? Look at the world around us. Mindless violence, corruption, inhumanity to fellow human beings, particularly to women and children, corporate opulence in the face of grinding poverty, inequality of income brought about by unbridled capitalism. Does anyone heed Gandhi's teachings these days? He asked. Some of it was referred to by my good friend Kamal. The UN is tackling all these problems today. While accepting the validity of some aspects of my friend's statement, I however felt that even in this atmosphere of doom and gloom, there would have to be some uplifting messages as well. Hence today, my search for such messages in Gandhiji's teachings and the impact on contemporary society. Although Gandhiji's life and work are well known, allow me to spend a few moments to dwell on the formative influences of his life, particularly the theme of today's talk, non-violence. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, endearingly called Bapu, or reverently called Dr. Mahatma, the great soul, the founding father of modern India, one who successfully mobilized the seething masses of India and gave the Indian nationalist struggle its unique character. He had pretty humble beginnings like most of us. Unlike the other Indian greats like Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose or Swami Vivekananda, he was no child prodigy. At his middle school at Porbandar and later at high school in Rajkot, he was regarded as a mediocre student. He never outperformed others in school or at the playing field. In fact, he passed his matriculation exam with difficulty, married, and became a young father. Subsequently, while in Bombay, he found it difficult to set up his legal practice because of his overwhelming shyness, and instead returned to his hometown Rajkot to make a modest living drafting petitions for litigants. This was the humble beginning of a man who was destined to challenge the mighty British Empire and enrage Sir Winston Churchill, who called him the naked fakir. And the challenge was met was not through the might of armies, but through the belief in and practice of the principle of nonviolence. If there was something that set Gandhi apart from the other boys of his age, it was his love for the Indian classics. From early childhood, he loved hearing his mother narrate stories of Shravana and King Harishchandra. In fact, he was so enamored by these two idealized icons of truth and unfailing moral courage that he would enact their stories over and over again during playtime. He later wrote, quote, "It haunted me, and I was affected Harishchandra to myself times without number," end of quote. It is this very early indication with truth and acknowledging it as a supreme guiding principle that was the sole extraordinary strength in a very ordinary boy. And it is this quality that was going to shape the future Mahatma that we know today. The guiding principle of his life would remain God is truth, which he would later amend further to truth is God. This is what is unique about Gandhi. He's not a remote embodiment of a country's idealized past or a mere receptacle of a cultural ethnography. His philosophy is pragmatic. It is real-time, emanating from the very tangible, humdrum, everyday Indian life, and can be practiced equally by the farmer who tills the land or the city dweller who rides his two-wheeler through the smoke-filled streets of any metro. He acknowledged the same when he wrote in 1936, quote, "There is no such thing as Gandhism, and I do not want to leave any sect after me. I do not claim to have originated any new principle or doctrine. I have simply tried on my own to apply the eternal truths to our daily lives and problems. I have nothing new to teach the world. Truth and nonviolence are as old as the hills." End of quote. It was in South Africa that Gandhi discovered himself and the Western world of imperialists and expansionists on their part. They discovered an unflinching opponent who had the moral strength to relentlessly stand by his convictions. While fighting for the civil rights of impoverished Indian indentured labor, Gandhi realized the true implications of colonialism and exactly how discrimination against colored people permeated the entire British Empire. As his political views sharpened, it was during the 21 years he spent in South Africa that his philosophy of Satyagraha evolved. Satyagraha, literally meaning devotion to truth, came to denote a non-violent resistance to justice. Gandhi very quickly realized that the British, with their overwhelming military power, could not be defeated in battlefield confrontation, but could be ousted with the collective moral opposition of an entire nation. This was where he was going to take a different route from Subhashchandra Bose. However, Gandhi also cautioned that non-violence with no implications of cowardice was the only option. Quote, "Where there is only a choice between cowardice and violence, I would advise violence," end of quote. Gandhi returned to India in 1915 and eventually took leadership of the Indian National Congress in 1920. His philosophy of non-violent resistance gave the nationalist struggle a new lease of life, a new patriotic objective to the teeming millions. Gandhi, in reinforcing his philosophy of nonviolence, had said, quote, "An eye for an eye only ends up making the whole world right," end of quote. As thousands of Indians welcomed their jail sentences or police flogging without a murmur, the nationalists proved the strength of their moral fiber and their faith in his leadership. Gandhi, on his part, realized that a fight for independence alone was not enough. His belief in truth and justice gradually widened to encompass a comprehensive humanitarian worldview. His social activism reached out to address the inherent wrongs of Indian society and sought sought justice for the untouchables as it did for the women. Indian women, plagued by centuries of discrimination, were drawn out from behind their purdah and encouraged to actively participate in their country's struggle.